The weakness of the Qing Empire against foreign aggression was exacerbated by this ongoing opium crisis and by crumbling infrastructure and famine in the countryside. Magistrates and officials addicted to opium were ineffective and often diverted money that should have been spent maintaining dams and irrigation canals to their own uses and their addictions. A series of peasant revolts swept through South China in the 1850s and 1860s, most notably the Taiping Rebellion, which a civil war that killed 30 million people over a 15-year period. The leader of the rebellion was Hong Xiuquan, a young man who had become unhinged after failing the grueling civil service examination four times. Hong had a vision and declared that he was the little brother of Christ, who had been sent to China to rid the land of the Manchu foreigners and their Confucianist culture. When Hong captured Nanjing in 1853 and made it his capital, he first killed all the Manchu men and then marched the women outside the city and burned them all to death. Hong's brutality and his strange interpretation of Christianity may have alienated some of the Europeans, but his ban on opium use antagonized them even more. Europe and Britain threw their support behind the Qing dynasty that they had just defeated in the Opium Wars. Hong and his allies were unable to avoid the temptation of quarreling and plotting against each other, which weakened their leadership. Two Taiping attempts to take Shanghai in 1860 and 1862 were both repelled with British and French assistance. In 1864, the Qing and their European allies retook Nanjing and ended the regime. But the resistance continued until 1871, when the last Taiping army was cornered and completely wiped out by government forces. Elsewhere in Asia, Japan's island self-confidence was also challenged by forced contact with foreigners in the middle of the 19th century. The Japanese home islands had been united under the same imperial dynasty since the 5th century, and the current emperor comes from the longest dynasty line of any monarch in the world. As an independent island nation, the Japanese were able to selectively accept or reject ideas and innovations from China, the powerful empire to their west. Often they would modify and incorporate aspects of Chinese culture, like writing and Buddhism, to their own circumstances. Native Japanese Shinto religion, for example, embraces the teachings of the Buddha. Beginning in the late 1100s, the emperor ruled indirectly, ceding power to shoguns, who commanded an army of lesser nobles known as samurai. The shoguns held back invasions by the Mongol armies in the 1200s and then maintained a large degree of separation for the empire from outside religions and outside cultures. This self-isolation ended in the mid-19th century when the United States, which had largely been shut out of European-dominated China, decided to try an open trade with Japan. American Commodore Matthew Perry sailed into Tokyo Bay in July of 1853 with a squadron of four warships and threatened to open fire on the capital if the Japanese refused to negotiate. To demonstrate, Perry destroyed several buildings around the harbor. Then the American fleet withdrew to allow the Japanese a year to consider their options. And when they returned a year later, the Japanese agreed to a treaty of peace and amity. 3 years later, a treaty of amity and commerce was signed, offered to the Japanese by American diplomats as a less invasive alternative to the aggressive colonialism of Britain and France in China following the Opium War. The Japanese decided, if we take the initiative, we can dominate. If we do not, we will be dominated. Modernization and the embrace of new technology went hand in hand with reorganization of the national government in what became known as the Meiji Restoration. The 15th Tokugawa shogun resigned in November of 1867, and direct control of the government was restored to the Emperor Meiji. The samurai class, which numbered nearly 2 million at this point, was slowly disbanded, and a nationwide universal military draft was instituted in 1873. Disgruntled samurai did rebel in 1876, and the Satsuma Rebellion grew into a short civil war in which the newly formed Imperial Japanese Army won a decisive victory. The industrialization of Japan accelerated, building the strong nation we'll see taking its place on the world stage in the next chapter. Meanwhile, in China, other rebellions, such as the Nian Rebellion, 1853 to 68, the Panthei Rebellion, 1855 to 73, and the Dongan Revolt from 1862 to 77, continued to challenge the Qing regime. China lost its control of its tribute state, Korea, to Japan in the First Sino-Japanese War. This humiliating defeat for the Qing Empire showed that their efforts to modernize China's military had failed and was a catalyst for a series of political actions led by revolutionaries like Sun Yat-sen. China ended the 19th century under the control of European powers and generally considered to be what they called, quote, the weak man of Asia. So, some questions for discussion. Compare the Taiping Rebellion to the United States Civil War, which happened about the same time. How were the two conflicts similar and how were they different? And then secondly, why do you think Japan was more able to rapidly respond to the challenge of Western culture? So that will end our coverage of the 19th century. I hope people found that interesting. Thanks for listening. I'll see you again next time.